Mr. Brooks, so how are you doing today?
Oh, I'm fine.
Great?
Okay. Yeah, I'm great.
I'm sitting here looking at this piece, and I'm very intrigued by it. I would like for you to explain to me the name of this piece and a couple of things about it.
Well, the piece is called Tending the Magnolia. It's a metaphorical title. And I use this magnolia tree as a symbolism to the growth of African Americans in America, from slavery to present day, with emphasis on the African American first family in the White House. So I'm trying to show how we pulled each other up, pushed each other up, did this and did that. Ordinary people as well as celebrated heroes made this thing happen to become totally a part of America and enjoy the American dream. Those broken branches represent the broken aspects of certain pursuits that were brought to end by the fallen heroes, which are represented by the blossoms lying on the ground as Malcolm X, Dr. King, and Mary Everson. They all had a following for equality. And I wanted to exemplify Thurgood Marshall, Justice Thurgood Marshall, when he was a young attorney. And when he won the Brown versus Board of Education of the people, and won the right, which I think was a very, very significant aspect of our history. When he won that case, it sort of opened the door to a lot of more aptness. We got education that we would have quality education for. Then we could go to any university that we sort of got, and they had set aside what was fatal to us. But believe it or not, I started this pain, which is called synopsis. Prior to this pain, but this pain, Tending Magnolia, was always on my mind. It was, and so I just had to paint it. I had to make a choice between synopsis and Tending the Magnolia. It was like a choice between two lovers, mm-hmm. You know? Because both paintings talk to me. They tell me things, what they want me to do, what color to lay here, you know? And without their voice, I doubt the painting would ever finish. So, synopsis had a quieter voice because my spirit was in Tending the Magnolia. I wanted to show this thing, but Tending the Magnolia would eventually turn into a triptych, develop into a triptych, 3 panels. And I'm taking my viewer, or attempt to take my viewer to Africa, and that journey to this country during those times, and that operation between then and now. It's a big story to tell, and I doubt if it could ever be done in 1 panel, so that's why I chose a triptych to make it happen in 3 panels.
Absolutely.
But there's another issue that I have, and I'm showing this in synopsis. Synopsis, she's still a little jealous because I put all my attention in Magnolia. And we have to reconcile our differences. So we will reconcile our differences completely, then I'll approach her again. And she...
So from my understanding, this is still an unfinished piece.
Right, right. But I want to show it on YouTube, mm-hmm. and several other social networks in order to create a following, because I think that this being an election, there's an issue, the issue of abortion. And this pandemic has a great deal to do with that issue. It's statement. I don't believe in abortion. I think it's a very, very cruel way to remedy the mistake of an adult. It's like an adult terminate a life because they made a bad choice. And that life, that human being that would have been, that developing human being, had nothing to do with that choice. So I don't think we should make that embryo, as they call it, suffer.
Excellent point.
So here, what I'm trying to show is that the beauty of life is sort of being crucified. And I use this utility pole and this butterfly being crucified on this utility pole in order to show that Sometimes those simple and beautiful things in life, we don't realize their beauty until they're gone. So I hope to convey that in this composition here, in synopsis. I hope synopsis will speak loudly to that extent. There'll be signs and just different, the conglomeration of metaphorical objects to sort of carry that statement to my viewer. Mm-hmm. And I hope they can perceive it. And the piece behind me, which is called The Inviolable Flame, is sort of a continuation of synopsis. Here what I'm showing is that those of us who believe that there is a supreme being, and that we have a creator, and that it's all about his choice on how he wanted his creation to operate. And we observe this from the nature of things. While a woman is the only means that we know that human life enters into the earth from her womb, then that to me is divine, because it is God's operation. So I'm trying to show here, and I'm using sort of metaphorical format, I'm using a suggestion of the nativity scene. There's a star to announce the birth of this golden child. And in my opinion, all birth, all life is golden. Golden. But suppose then that there's an objective of God to send to us a vessel contained with this good message for us, such as when Christ, Gandhi, Dr. King, all these people, they were like vessels. They came and they told us something that was a bit divine, that we can gather some correctness and propriety from. Well, if we relied on abortion, suppose we snuffed that out and prevented this operation, this natural operation, which is the nature of life, the nature of the human condition. So I think that to make these statements here, I'm trying to show that from the moment of conception into the exit from the womb, there are forces trying to snuff this out. And when it exits the womb, be careful. There's this force trying to blow this flame out, this inviolable flame, this light that could possibly come into the world and light the way for other people that could have this a certain amount of charity in its heart. And this operation, this contrary operation to that nature, comes with a bag of tricks sometimes. You know, they just trying to snuff this beauty out, this light that glows. So this little embryo, or this developed human being, exit this womb. And while he was trying to exit this womb, he and this evil spirit were trying to defeat each other in tic-tac-toe. So he couldn't win, so what he did, this evil force, what he did was devise a bag of tricks to blow this flame out, to snuff it out. And basically, most of my work have those metaphors. I like to say things that I think would or could be enlightening to some people. And perhaps they will get a message. And I don't think it's just my message, it's just some that makes sense to me. And these two pieces, they're not completed. But I'm letting them be seen on Facebook and other social networks. I want the progress to be noticed. I want some people to follow and see the development and see why a serious artist so urged to get this out. You know, and I think that's important. You know, it's something that I feel that I have to do.